Hey everybody, this is Brajesh here and you are watching CABA and Foventry. My dear friends, daughters are like flowers. They fill the world with beauty. Having a daughter is a blessing that brings a lot of joy and excitement in one's life. However, the Hindu Succession Act 1956 did injustice to daughters by making the provision that only male members shall be the co-partners in the ancestral property and not daughters. In today's video discussion, I will be doing the in-depth analysis related to the Supreme Court judgment in respect of daughters getting right in ancestral property and thereby correcting the injustice done by the Hindu Succession Act. This is a landmark judgment in respect of rights of daughters in their ancestral property as co-partner, and is equally important for male members of Hindu family also, governed by the Hindu Succession Act. Then, what all changes were made in Hindu Succession Act 1956 by the Amendment Act of 2005, and what is there in the judgment of Supreme Court in the case of Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma, which was decided by the Honorable Supreme Court on 11th August 2020. Keep watching this video till end in order to get the full benefit out of this video. If you like this video, then do share and subscribe this channel to get the further updates as soon as the new video is uploaded on my channel. The Hindu Succession Act talks about the inheritance and succession, and it tells the Hindus that how the property will pass on to the successors. So, who will be having how much share in the property is provided in the Hindu Succession Act 1956. This act is applicable on Hindus, Buddhists, Jains and Sikhs. The Hindu Succession Act 1956 talks about the two types of properties. Number one, the ancestral property, and number two, self-acquired property. Ancestral property means the property acquired from forefathers that is not made by the individual himself from his own earned funds, and self-acquired property is that property which is made by an individual from his own funds after earning the same, and he has not got it from his ancestors or forefathers. So there are these two types of properties specified under the Hindu Succession Act 1956. There is a structure in a joint Hindu family which is provided under the Hindu Succession Act 1956. Say for instance, there is Mr. A who is having ancestral property and he is having his wife. Then he is having his son and daughter. Then he is having his grandson. Then he is having great-grandson. And then he is having great-great-grandson. Under the Hindu Succession Act, there are two types of terms used. One is member and second one is co-partner. The family structure which I have just discussed with you, here, either has the son or daughter or husband or wife. All these persons will be the member of that family. Now, the question will be coming into your mind whether all these members shall also be the co-partner of that family. The answer is big no. The co-partners are those persons who have a right in the ancestral property. They can claim their right on the ancestral property as a co-partner. Before the amendment of 2005 in Hindu Succession Act 1956, it was provided that the co-partners shall be those persons who are the lineal descendant from common ancestors. Only those persons that is lineally descendant will get the co-partnery rights in the ancestral property. So who all will be the co-partners is the next question. Before the amendment of 2005, in the Hindu Succession Act 1956, the co-partners were only male lineal descendants and not the female one. If there was daughter, wife or widow in the family, then they will not qualify as a co-partner. This was a big issue in the Hindu Succession Act concerning gender discrimination toward female members of the family. Then, for instance, if A is having acquired ancestral property, then who will be the co-partner for that property? His son, his grandson, then great-grandson and great-great-grandson shall be the co-partner, and this rule shall go on and on, meaning thereby that three generations next to the holder of the property shall be the co-partners. If anyone in the hierarchy is dead, then the next one in that line or hierarchy will be included in the co-partners and he will become the co-partner for that ancestral property. This is called the survivorship rule. This rule is provided in section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act. One of the main criticisms of this survivorship rule was that only male members were the co-partners. Only male members can acquire the property. Therefore, according to the Hindu Succession Act 1956, only male lineal descendants were co-partners for the purposes of ancestral property, means only those were having the right in the ancestral property if they were male and not the female one. This was a big social injustice to the female members of the family, and therefore the wife, daughter or widow were not entitled to become the co-partner in the ancestral property, and therefore they were not eligible to get any share in the ancestral property as per the Hindu Succession Act before the 2005 amendment. This was a basic problem in the Hindu Succession Act, which was corrected by the amendment of 2005 in the Hindu Succession Act 1956. However, if a person makes his will and he specifies in that will that certain percentage of share of his property will go to his spouse, that is his wife, and some other percentage will go to his son, and some other percentage will go to his daughter, and remaining will go to any third person to whom he pleases, then the property is divided according to that will only. However, there is a condition or limitation with respect to the will. A person can make the will only for his self-acquired property, that is, the property which he himself has generated from his own earned fund and has not acquired from his parents or forefathers. Only his self-acquired property can be divided as per his will, but the ancestral property which he has acquired from his forefathers cannot be divided according to his will. Up till 2005, the ancestral property was divided as per the provisions of Hindu Succession Act 1956. Then what happened in the year 2005? An amendment was made into the Hindu Succession Act 1956, which cancelled the survivorship rule and introduced testamentary succession and intestate succession in the Hindu Succession Act 1956. According to the testamentary succession, the testament is being made by an individual, that is, to make a will by that individual, and according to that will, that gentleman can give his self-acquired property to anybody, maybe his spouse, that is his wife or husband, maybe his son or his daughter or any third person to whom he pleases. If an individual wish to distribute his self-acquired property according to the will, then there is no issue. The issues came in the intestate succession, that is, where an individual has died without making any will, or where any ancestral property is to be divided, then intestate succession will come into play, because the ancestral property cannot be divided as per will. This division can be made as per the Hindu Succession Act 1956. A person can make the will only for his self-acquired property only. The amendment of 2005 introduced four classes which comprises different persons. For example, class 1 includes widow or husband, son or daughter, and the like persons. Therefore, the amendment of 2005 prescribed that in case of a death of a person, if there is an ancestral property, the first right on the ancestral property shall be with the widow, son, and daughter. And these all three are having equal rights in the property. So, the property that is ancestral property shall be divided among us these three categories of persons equally. This was the amendment of 2005 which abrogated survivorship rule from the Hindu Succession Act and introduced the testamentary succession and intestate succession in the Hindu Succession Act 1956 by the amendment of 2005. The daughters also became the co-partners since birth in the ancestral property like sons, and the daughters will have equal liability like sons also from 9 September 2005, which is the date of enforcement of 2005 amendment. Let us see now that the amendment of 2005, which was brought to address the issue of rights of daughters and made them co-partners in the ancestral property, brought what new issues or problems? It also brought certain other imbalances or problems in its implementation. Now, I will discuss two more cases decided by Supreme Court, also in addition to the present case of Supreme Court, where the daughters have been given the right in ancestral property by treating them the co-partners. My dear friends, the enactment date of 2005 amendment was 9 September 2005. The issue or confusion which arose due to this amendment was that whether it is mandatory that the father should be alive on 9 September 2005 in order to get the right in ancestral property by the daughter. For instance, if father died in 2004, that is, before this amendment of 2005 came into being, then whether the daughter can claim her right in the ancestral property or not. This issue arose due to the amendment of 2005. If you like this video, then do share and subscribe this channel to get the further updates as soon as the new video is uploaded on my channel. The issue or confusion which arose due to 2005 amendment was that whether it is mandatory that the father should be alive on 9 September 2005 in order to get the right in ancestral property by the daughter. The answer to this question was given by the Honorable Supreme Court in the three cases which I am going to discuss with you now. And final answer to this question was given by the Honorable Supreme Court on 11th August 2020 in the case of Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma, and all the confusions and controversies surrounding to this amendment of 2005 were put to rest by the Honorable Supreme Court. The first case is of Prakash versus Phulwati, which was decided by the Honorable Supreme Court by its two-member bench consisting of Justice Anil Dave and Justice A.K. Goel, in 2016. In this case, the Supreme Court held that it was necessary that father should be alive on 9 September 2005 in order to claim the right in the ancestral property by daughter. It was held that the living co-partners only can pass on the right to living daughter and not otherwise. Hence, as per this principle propounded by the Supreme Court in this case, it was mandatory that father should be alive on 9 September 2005. Second case on this issue was decided by the Honorable Supreme Court after 2 years, that is, in the year 2018. That is, in the case of Dhanamma versus Amar Singh, which was again decided by the two-member bench of the Honorable Supreme Court that was headed by Justice A.K. Sikri and Justice Ashok Bhushan. In this case, the court held that though the father died in the year 2001, meaning thereby that the father was not alive on 9 September 2005, still the daughter will get the right in the ancestral property. These two judgments gave diagonally opposite judgments on the issue of the right of daughter in ancestral property. In first case, it was held that it is necessary that father should be alive on 9 September 2005, while in the second case, it was held by the court that it is not necessary that the father should be alive on 9 September 2005. The issue which arose was whether it was prerequisite that father should be alive on 9 September 2005 in order to get the right by daughter in the ancestral property. Therefore, both these judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court given by the two-member bench gave conflicting decisions and they created more confusion than solution for this problem. And everybody was in a dilemma that whether he should follow Phoolwati case or Dhanamma case. Finally, the answer to this issue and confusion was given by the three-member bench of the Honorable Supreme Court in a judgment in the case of Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma on 11th August 2020, headed by Justice Arun Mishra, Justice M. R. Shah and Justice Abdul Nazir. Therefore, the confusion created by earlier two decisions of the Supreme Court that whether father should be alive on 9 September 2005 or not in order to daughter getting the right in ancestral property was put to rest by the three-member bench of Supreme Court in the case of Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma by its decision dated 11 September 2020. It is held by the Honorable Supreme Court that the woman's right to the ancestral property is by birth. Therefore, the daughter also gets the copartenary right same as son gets in his ancestral property by birth. Whether father is alive or not does not matter. And this does not affect their right. Justice Arun Mishra pronounced the judgment which gave equal rights to daughters in ancestral property. Daughters must be given equal rights as sons. Daughter remains a loving daughter throughout life. The daughter shall remain a co-partner throughout life, irrespective of whether the father is alive or not, Justice Mishra said while pronouncing this landmark judgment on 11th August 2020. Concerning gender discrimination to a daughter who always remains a loving daughter, the Supreme Court quoted its case of Savita Samvedi versus Union of India, reported in 1996, 2 SCC 380. A son is a son until he gets a wife. A daughter is a daughter throughout her life. This three-member bench overruled the contrary observations made in Prakash versus Phoolwati case by the Supreme Court. To sum up this issue, the chronology is as under. Before 1956 Act, Shastric and customary laws were applicable in the country which governed the Hindus, and they varied from region to region. Sometimes even it varied in same region on caste basis. In the year 1956, all these laws were codified into one law, that is Hindu Succession Act 1956. As per this act, number 1, the ancestral property used to devolve by survivorship rule only. Number 2, only males were the co-partners up to 3 generations. And number 3, women were not recognized as co-partner. This system remained prevalent in the country from the year 1956 till the year 2005, when amendment was made in Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956, which abrogated the survivorship rule, and in place of survivorship, testamentary or intestate succession was introduced in the Hindu Succession Act 1950. The amendment also recognized daughters as co-partners. However, this amendment created some confusion as to whether the daughter can claim the right in ancestral property if her father is not alive on 9 September 2005. Then came Honorable Supreme Court with its judgment in 2016 in the case of Prakash versus Phoolwati, and held in this case the rule of living co-partner and living daughter. That is, father has to be alive on 9 September 2005. That is the effective date of 2005 amendment. And then only daughters can claim the benefit in ancestral property under the 2005 amendment. Daughters are entitled to co-personary right in ancestral property since birth. However, in the second case in 2018, that is in the case of Danamma versus Amar Singh, it was held that if father is dead on or before 9 September 2005, even then the ancestral property shall pass on to daughters equally, and their right shall be protected. Therefore, both the judgment of 2016 and 2018 were diagonally opposite to each other and were conflicting. Then came the final verdict on 11th August 2020 in the case of Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma. In this case, court upheld the judgment of Danamma versus Amar Singh and held that the daughter have right in the ancestral property since birth like sons. Whether father is alive or not does not make any difference, and their right remain intact and protected. My dear friends, this was the discussion on daughter's right in her ancestral property as co-partner, and the injustice done by the Hindu Succession Act 1956 with the daughters in the year 1956 was set right and corrected by the Honorable Supreme Court judgment of the year 2020. The link for the judgment for Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma is given in the description below. Hope you might have liked this video. That's it for now. Stay safe and healthy. Bye-bye.